You know, and one of the things that we hear, not only in Isaiah 6, but in the Revelation, in the that picture of last things, is the angels, or those gathered around the throne of God, saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." That's the only thing in the Bible that where it repeats it like that three times. Holy, holy, holy. It is just, I think, talking about the completeness of the holiness of God. You know, last Sunday when we started talking about the second coming, or the coming back of Jesus Christ, I'm sure there were probably people in the room that said something like, you know, this is kind of obscure to me. This is a, you know, it's hard for me to think about that when I've got bills to pay now, when I've got my family to take care of now, when I've got my job to keep up right now, when I've got, you know, I've deal with health issues, or, I mean, I'm sure some of you probably, all those things were running through your mind, and what is going to happen in what we call the eternal state is obscure to us a little bit. It's hard for us to get our arms around the idea that is reality. And one of the things that the second coming of Jesus Christ, and the reality of the second coming of Jesus Christ does for us, is it is kind of a reset button on reality. That the most real thing is what is to come. In some respects, we live in someone has described it like this, we live in a cold, dark cave. And if we stay in that cold, dark cave that we call this life, you know, we're not going to see the fullness of what God has in store for us. But if we'll come out of that cave and look to the horizon, and look to the coming of the Lord, we will see this amazing mountain range, this beautiful mountain range that God has in store for us, that He has prepared for us. I have not seen nor ear heard what God has prepared for those who love Him. And so there's this reality check of the fact that Jesus Christ is coming again. And one of the things that we're going to have to struggle with in this life, and if we're going to be followers of Jesus Christ in the world in which we live, we're going to have to fight for reality. Because this life is sort of like somebody jumping up in front of our vision, doing this, and the life to come sometimes seems like a whisper. A whisper, though it may be, it is coming. It is coming. It is a reality check, specifically on what really matters. On what really matters in life. What is life all about? And why does it matter? Does it matter how I live my life right now? Does it matter the direction of my life right now? Does it matter my thought life? And does it matter that I'm in the Word of God every day? Does it matter that I'm praying, that I'm seeking the Lord, that I'm coming to know Him now? We talk around here a lot about knowing Christ. We want you to know Christ and who you are in Him. And I'm telling you, it matters because He is the same right now in glory. He is the same right now that as He will be when you stand before Him one day. He is the same God. He is the same Christ. And it matters. It matters more than anything else. More than anything else. And I know that's hard for us to get our arms around, especially when life can be hard, when life can be, you know, I mean, life's doing this, and the eternal state that we will be in seems like a whisper. But I want you to understand, it really, really matters. Now, the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about that. We're going to be in Revelation chapter 4, verses 8 through 11. We're going to be in Revelation chapter 5, verses 1 through 10. We're not going to cover a whole lot of ground today. We're just going to kind of introduce this. And I want you to see the fact that this really, really does matter. The Bible warns us, Jesus warned us. He said, "See that no one leads you astray. See that no one gets your eyes off of reality." The Apostle Paul said to us, "In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers." So for unbelievers, for those who have not put their trust in Jesus Christ, there is an active deception going on. And the deceiver is called here the god of this world. We know that it is Satan. He has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from what? To keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. To keep the world from seeing the reality of Jesus Christ. But I've got some good news for you today as a believer. And I've got some good news for you if you're an unbeliever. First of all, you can come to Christ. You can have your eyes open. That is a picture. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. That meaning he illuminates what is real. He makes known to us what is real. And those of us who have put our trust in him, here's what the scripture says to us. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, that spirit of deception, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might understand, that we might see clearly the things freely given to us by God. That is the transforming work of the Holy Spirit in your life and in my life. That is the work of regeneration that takes place in your life and my life. That is what God has done for us. He has opened our eyes to what is really real. Hallelujah. So that we are, even in a world that is bent on deception, we are not deceived. Now, three life-shaping realities that are revealed to us as followers of Jesus Christ. Reality number one, there is an eternal existence for believers called heaven. There is an eternal existence. And you say, that's Christianity 101. I knew that when I was a kid. But I think if we're honest today, most of us admit, I don't think much about it. Now, the older we get, maybe the more we think about it. Isn't it amazing that as our eyesight here fades, our eyesight there gets illuminated? It's like all of a sudden things get like black and white here as we get older, but they get HD there. Right? They get HD. We begin to see clearly. But here's the thing. I mean, how foolish is it that we don't think about there? Right? I mean, if you're a male born in the United States of America, which I'm assuming most of you probably were, and you live an average of 76.4 years. If you're female, you live an average of 81.2 years. Average that out, or kind of, you know, for those of you mathematicians who want to have the I's dotted, the T's crossed, that comes to 78.94 years at an average for all of us together. I mean, round it up, 79 years you have here. Now, I think I could be safe in saying eternity's longer. Right? Eternity's longer. And how foolish is it for us to focus only on the here and now when there is a there and then, and in many respects it is more real than here and now. It is what God has prepared for us. I mean, we learned that when we were a kid. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have what? Eternal life. Everlasting life. Life eternal. That's what is in store for us. The psalmist in Psalm 39 really speaks with reality here when he says, O Lord, make known my end and what is the measure of my days. Let me know how fleeting I am. Behold, you have made my days a few handbreadths, and my lifetime is as nothing before you. Surely all mankind stands as a mere breath. And then there's a word that we don't really know how to translate. It's spoken of often in the Psalms, I think about 100 times in the Scripture. And it's just the simple word, pronounce it, Selah. And the best we understand, it probably was a musical interval or a musical rest for those of you who are musicians. Some even say that it likely was a time to stop. They sang the psalms, right? They sang the psalms, and while they were singing it, it was a sign to stop and reflect. To think about what has just been said. What has just been said? Life's short. Life is short. So what does he conclude? Surely a man goes about in a shadow. Surely for nothing they are in turmoil. Man heaps up wealth and does not know who will gather. Now, is that reality? Is that reality? I mean, you build your bank account, you build your life here. And what for? I mean, you're going to leave it all behind, right? Nobody takes you all behind their eternity, you know, their eternal existence, right? Nobody gets to go with a U-Haul. And now, O Lord, for what do I wait? My hope is in you. Folks, that's such a simple statement, but there is so much packed in that little statement. My hope is in you. It is not in this life. It is not in the things, even the best things of this life, pale in comparison to Him, right? We have, so reality number one, there is an eternal existence for believers called heaven. Now, as a people who believe that, I trust we at least believe that, you know, what do you look forward to when you think about heaven? When you think about our eternal existence, the second coming of Jesus Christ, what do you look forward to? Well, you might say, I look forward to the beauty of heaven. And wow, the scriptures are picturesque about that. Some people say it's figurative. Some people say it's literal. I don't know. I just think we're going to walk around going like that all the time. Day after day. It's never going to get old. We're never going to come to a place where we say, oh, that's old hat, right? How many of us live right here and haven't been to the Smoky Mountains in 10 years? Well, good. All right, good. Good for the mountains, right? Yeah. Yeah. Do we take for granted things like that? The beauty of the world around us? I don't think you're ever going to take for granted our eternal existence and what's there. What we call heaven. That's one thing to look forward to there. But another thing you might look forward to there is you might want to look forward to the changes in us. We're told that we'll be given a new body and that we will be sinless, that nothing holy can enter in there. I mean, I'm good with that. I'm for that. I don't know about you, but I kind of look forward to the day that I don't fail my Savior anymore. And another thing you might look forward to there is what we call the no mores of heaven. I mean, that there's no more sorrow, that there'll be no more death, no more tears. We sang about that. No more dying, the no mores of heaven. That's great. I mean, all of those things. No more suffering in heaven, particularly if you're going through a time of suffering in your life. Can you imagine what that meant to John, who wrote the Revelation and saw the Revelation and he, in the persecuted church? Many of his friends had been martyred. They'd given up their lives for the sake of the faith. Now he's there on the Isle of Patmos, having been exiled to this place. He's cut off from everybody around him. I imagine the no mores were pretty attractive to him. But maybe the thing you look forward to most about heaven is you're going to get reunited with loved ones. And that's good. I think all these things are good. I mean, my mother's been there for a long time now, and I was thinking yesterday, you know, I wonder what she would think of all that's going on around us now. I wonder what she would think of her grandchildren, great-grandchildren. I miss her, and I look forward. I'm going to see her again. I'm going to talk about that on Mother's Day. But you know what? All of those things pale in comparison to this one thing, that Jesus Christ there. We're going to see Jesus. The Apostle Paul said this, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We await what? A Savior. We await a Savior from there. Paul wrote again to the church at Philippi, and he said, To me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. And yet, which I choose, I cannot tell. I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ. I mean, Paul was in prison when he wrote this. He was in prison for his faith. Notice what he doesn't say. He doesn't say, my desire is to be in a place where there's no more suffering. And I'm sure that was on his mind. My desire is to be reunited with people I know who put their trust in Jesus Christ, and I will be there with them. My desire is to see the beauty. My desire is to see all of those things. But what does he say? My desire is to depart and be with Christ. And so here's the point. In Christ Jesus, for us, the reality number two, Christ Jesus is the supreme treasure of eternity. He is the supreme treasure. And if he's the supreme treasure there, what ought that to lead to? If Christ Jesus is the supreme treasure of our eternity, it only makes sense that he be our supreme treasure right now. That the most important thing in life be simply him. That everything else fades out and he comes in. That the most important thing in our lives right now would be him. And I know that's a little obscure for us. Listen, I understand that. That's a little hard for us to get our arms around. It's sort of like if you were telling me, maybe you just moved into your dream house. And you were telling me about your dream house. And you said, you know, I just love the foundation of my dream house. I've never heard anybody say that. I mean, you might have... Randy, maybe you've heard somebody say that. I don't know. I've never, you know, we had all the things, the beauty, I just love the way the walls were built, the studs were put in there just right and everything. I just love the way it's all supported. I love the foundation of my house. I don't hear anybody say that. But you know what? Take it away and what do you have? Right? Take it away and everything comes crumbling down. I want you to understand, you take Jesus away from this life and everything comes crumbling down. I don't care how beautiful life you may, the life you may build. I don't care how amazing your life might be. Take away Jesus and everything crumbles. And in the scripture we read, Peter wrote, for it stands in scripture, behold, I'm laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious. And whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, for the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Now do you see what he's saying there? Those who do not believe look past the reality of the cornerstone, the foundation. So what happens? Everything crumbles. Everything crumbles. The beautiful life you build without a foundation ultimately falls apart because it was not built on the one foundation that would hold it, Christ Jesus. But those who believe will not be put to shame. And the way that looks to me is this. Well, you know, you will not have to say, you may, if the foundation of your life, the true foundation of your life is Jesus Christ, you will never have to say, well, that was stupid. I invested everything in a house that did not have a foundation that would hold it. You'll never have to say that. You'll never be put to shame. If you build your life upon the reality of the foundation of Jesus Christ, you'll never have to say, now I look like an idiot. I built my whole life on something that could not hold it. And it came crumbling down. It would be sort of like buying a house and never checking out the foundation. And never checking out how it was built. I don't care how beautiful it is. It is not going to hold. It is not going to stand. And you can build your entire life upon lesser things, and they will not hold in the day when it matters. The Apostle Paul said we as believers, if we're not careful, can be fooled in this. Look at what he says, 1 Corinthians 3. Now, no one can lay a foundation other than that which was laid, which is Christ Jesus. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, He will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. In other words, you've either focused on what really matters here in your average 78.94 years, or you've focused on things that do not matter, and ultimately there's going to be a test, even for believers. We will not be judged based upon our sin or not sin, because our sin has been forgiven, right? Our sin has been caught up in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ died for our sin. But there will be a reward system, and I don't fully understand this, and I don't have all the answers in this. The Bible over and over again points to the fact that there will be a reward for those who have invested their lives in what really matters in Jesus Christ. And for others, there is what? Loss. There is loss. Even though it says you will be saved, there will be loss. Now, here's the thing. We're just going to barely get into this today, so hang with me. How do we make sure we're focusing on what is reality now? How do we make sure that we're focusing on what really matters right now? And the first thing is simply this. Gaze intently on who Jesus Christ is there. Look at who he is there. Gaze intently on it. And who he is there, I want you to understand, is who he is right now. That the one you will see there is who he is right now. You are right now in his presence. This is who he is. This is everything it says of him here in these passages you can say of him right now. And what does it say of him? And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around them within. Don't get all freaked out by that. Alright? I know that sounds a little strange. It talks about 24 elders, and it talks about these creatures. And honestly, I don't think anybody knows exactly who these are. There's a lot of surmising about who these are, and it may be so simple we just miss it as human beings. I don't know. But I'll tell you who I think they are. Right before this, it talks about 24 elders. Now it talks about four creatures. You know who I think it is? I think it's all people and all things. All people, 24 elders, the very likely symbolizing the leaders of the 12 tribes of Israel and the 12 apostles. Symbolizing all people here. And four living creatures. And if you look right before this, it gives a description of these four living creatures. And I believe these four living creatures are everything that has been created. So what do we see? All people and all things are standing before the Lord. And it says of them, and day and night they never cease to say, and there's those three words we just sang, holy, holy, holy. One word three times. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and who is to come. What do they say? They proclaim the holiness of the one who was and is to come. Who is it speaking of here? Speaking of Christ Jesus, our Lord, our King. This is the response of every person and everything that stands before him. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And what do they do? What do they do? And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne, and they do what? They worship him who lives forever and ever. Then what do? They cast their crowns before the throne. Now I believe simply the crowns are every good gift and every good thing that God has placed in our hands. Every accomplishment, every joy of this life, every good thing in this life. I mean, think of the best things of your life right now. Think about them. Name them in your mind. What are they? They mark your holding one right there. Right? The best thing in your life. You're sitting beside one too. Right? Amen? Amen, LaShonda? All right. Think about every good thing of your life. Every gift that God has given to you. Everything that has been placed in your hands. Your bank account, there's nothing wrong with having a bank account, right? Your job, the abilities, the gifts that you've been given, the things that everything that's been placed in your hand. Name it in your mind right now. Every good thing. And what are you going to do with it? You're going to cast it as crowns before you. You're going to come to such a reality of who He is that every good thing that you thought was the end all in life is going to be laid before you. Everything. Everything. And you know one thing's going to be laid before you? It's going to freak you out right here. Some of you more than others. Control. Because you're not your own. You're bought with a price. That's reality. That's right now reality. That you are not in control of your life is reality. And you know what you're going to do? You're going to cast that before Him too. You're going to give up. You're going to surrender. You're going to say, it's all yours. You look up at the throne and you see who He is, and there will be no other thing that you can do than this. To cast all your crowns at the foot of the throne. I mean, it kind of puts in perspective, doesn't it? It kind of puts things in perspective. When you begin to understand that, you begin to realize that. And what I want you to see is this. When the reality of who Christ Jesus is there sets in, we see the reality of the Word, of everything in life. Do you understand what I'm saying? I hope you're tracking with me here. I hope you've not checked out. I hope you're tracking with me. This is so important, folks. What has happened is you have been brought to a point of reality about everything in life. All of a sudden, all the pretense is taken away, all the delusion of life, and all the things that we try to pretend are true, are not, we realize they're not true. Not true. What is true? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and who is to come. Every other reality is going to melt at the face of that. And what I want you to see this week, as we look at this, and the next week, we're going to talk about this even more and how this impacts our lives. That this coming to reality is what we so desperately need. Not just there, but here. Not just then, but now. Why would we want to live our lives in delusion when we can know what's really right and what is really true? What is, if you will, really real? And that's what this is bringing us to. As we come before the One who was, the One who is, and the One who is to come. It kind of makes it come real, doesn't it? When Jesus said, do not lay up your treasures on earth, where moth and rust and destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. I mean, all these things are temporary. But lay up your treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So we lay those crowns before Him, and then listen to what He says. They say, worthy are you, our Lord God and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. Now we're going to stop right there today. We're going to come back next week. Those of you who filled in the blanks, don't freak out. We'll come back and fill them in next week. But here's the thing, folks. Can you understand what's happening here? Can you understand why it matters that we have some understanding of what is coming. Not what is coming, more accurately, who is coming? Who is this? Why does it matter right now, today? You can go through your life and live outside the realms of what is real, and you can live outside the realms of reality. You can live in that cold, dark cave, or you can see the glory of what is to come, of what is out there in front of us, and what is before us. And understanding what this means to us, that Jesus Christ, this Jesus who is described for us here, is the one who is coming again. And it doesn't just matter in the sweet by and by. It matters in the nitty gritty here and now. Right now. In your life. In my life. So I'm just going to ask you right now to bow your head. And we're just going to take a moment. When you think about the crowns that it speaks of here, what are those crowns in your life? What are those crowns that the Lord would have you lay before Him right now? I mean, I'm not talking about the bad things in your life. Yeah, sin, I mean, sin, we can agree, right? The Bible says it's wrong, it's wrong. But I'm talking about the good things. I'm talking about the things that you're tempted to make gods right now. Idols in your life right now. The things that, as good as they are, can obscure you. Would you right now just take that thing? I mean, name it. Name it. What it is. It might be your children, your family. It might be your house. It might be your bank account. It might be all of these things. It might be your suffering, your struggles, your heartaches. Those are the things that are weighing on you right now. They're the most prominent thing in your life. It might be those things, too. What do you do?